this past fall, on October 11th, Pope Benedict XVI announced a year of faith. I know all of us were very familiar with that, and we got a lot of emails about it and information about it and kind of wondered what it was about. Well, that was in commemoration of 50 years since Vatican II. I'm not going to talk any more about Vatican II because these three gentlemen who are here with us tonight were there, and they were present, and we have such a great privilege in having them able to come and share their stories and their experiences of what it was like to be there at that time in Rome. So I am going to introduce all three of them, and then I am going to turn the program over to them. We will have a little bit of time at the end for question and answer, so if something comes up during the talk that you want to ask a question, just hold on to it and we'll come back to you and do question and answer at the end. Okay, we're going to start here to my far left. This is Father Salvatore DeGeorge. He is currently the pastor of St. Patrick's in Houston. He is a native Houstonian. There are not very many of us that can say that. He was active in St. Joseph's Parish, and he went to high school with the Oblates of Mary Immaculate. And they must have had a great influence on him because he later did join the Oblates of Mary Immaculate. He was sent to Rome in 1959 to study philosophy and theology there, and he was there until 1966. Then he returned to Texas, where he taught high school seminary in San Antonio. I bet that was an interesting period of time. And then he returned to parish work. He got a master's degree at Loyola in Chicago, a little bit of time out of Texas, where he got a degree in counseling psychology. And he has done parish work in Huntsville and Brownsville. And now he has returned to this the pastoral work at St. Patrick's in Houston. So we welcome you, Father DeGeorge. I'm sure you're not quite familiar with the man seated in the center here. Father Borski was ordained in 1967. He has a bachelor's degree in philosophy from St. Mary's in Houston, a licentiate in sacred theology, did I say that right? Okay, from Gregorian University in Rome, and a master's degree in religious studies from the Catholic University in Washington, D.C. He was at St. Mary's Seminary in Houston for over 25 years, where for 19 of those years, he served as the rector, and we have been very blessed to have him here with us at St. Martha's for 12 years. Mm-hmm. Is that right? Okay. That's what I thought. Okay. And finally, welcome, Father Borski. Father Borski comes complete with fan club and cheering section, so.
I paid them to be here.
Yes. I will look forward to my check later tonight. Father Donald Nesti is in the Congregation of the Holy Spirit. He served as the 10th president of Duquesne University in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, where he was born. He was ordained on May the 30th, 1963, and he is the founder and the current director of the Center for Faith and Culture at the University of St. Thomas in Houston, and he's also a professor of theology there. I was privileged to take a class from Father Nesti. So please welcome Father Nesti. Okay, and I'm going to step out of the way and turn it over to Father Borski.
Well, thank you for being here. Actually, this evening was kind of done about a year or so ago at Maureen Bakke's home. She had a friend of hers from Chicago that was writing a book and concerning Vatican II and experiences. So the three of us met at her home along with Archbishop Fiorenza, who was also in Rome at the time. And so we had such a wonderful time. I mentioned to Carla that it would be nice to kind of repeat something like this for the parish, because as Sal mentioned, it's like the gathering of veterans from World War II. We're not going to be around too much longer, so. My part of the program to begin with is simply to give you kind of a introduction, kind of tell you what was going on as the council was called, and then I'll make a few comments about the first document that was promulgated by the council, and that was the Constitution on the Divine Liturgy. I think most of us would say that we have heard about Vatican II, whether we have read the documents or not, but what we might be surprised to know is that scholars from all religions have studied and read carefully these documents, whether they were other Christian theologians, whether they were Buddhist, atheist, whether they were members of world religions. They would consider the Second Vatican Council as something like Mount Everest, an event of that stature within the not only the Roman Catholic Church, but within churches themselves and its impact upon our world. It is still the foundational event for the governance of the Roman Catholic Church, as well as it provides foundational documents and directions for dialogue on with interfaith or ecumenical gatherings. I think to understand it, we need to kind of see what transpired right before the council was called. On October the 9th, 1958, Eugenio Maria Giuseppe Giovanni Pacelli died in Rome. We knew him as Pope Pius XII. He was elected Pope in 1939 and would govern and lead the church through the dark hours of World War II. He was a canon lawyer. He was also a diplomat. He was also Vatican Secretary of State. But he was, in many ways, an aristocrat. He was an intellectual, an introvert, but if you would see him, he was somewhat gaunt. He was had a regal pose, if you will, and as someone mentioned, that he described him as pontifical, that from the thin hair of his Roman head to the extremity of his smallest toe, he was, as the Italians would say, il capo, the boss, and he personified the institutional church at the time. On October the 28th of that year, when the white smoke emerged from the Vatican stovepipe, the elderly Angelo Giuseppe Roncalli was elected Pope and chose the name of John the 23rd. Everyone thought that he was simply an interim pope. He was of peasant stock. He was a former soldier. He had a hooked nose, and he was kind of like the Jolly Green Giant, round, outgoing, completely at home with the common people. And he told stories, and he cracked jokes. Someone asked him, how many worked at the Vatican? And he says, I think about half. He was everyone's favorite uncle, and they could call on him in time of trouble. His presentations or talks were simple, to the point, and understandable. He was, as the Italians would say, my papa. And almost immediately, the new pope indicated that it was time to open the windows and bring fresh air into the church. In January 1959, he called for three events. One would be what is called the Synod within the Diocese of Rome, which they had never held before. Another was to have a general council, and another was to have revision of canon law. And so we heard different words being used in the press. Aggiornamento, which was an updating. we heard the word ecumenical, a Greek word that meant worldwide. And so the General Council, or the Ecumenical Council, was called by Pope John the 23rd. It would be the 21st such gathering. The first one is considered the Council of Jerusalem, when the church decided that it was no longer just a Jewish sect, but it was to welcome Gentiles into the church as well. The next one would have been the Council of Nicaea, from which we get the Nicene Creed, the year 325. But in recent centuries, there were only two: the Council of Trent in the 16th century, and then there was the Vatican I, which was called in the 1900s. That council began, and 2 years later had to be abandoned because Garibaldi came in to Rome to unify what is the Italian states. There was no country as Italian, but to unify all the city states into one country. And so the bishops went home. And so when John the 23rd called his council, he called it the Vatican II, to continue what was left undone by Vatican I. And he also called for a new Pentecost in the church. The reason he did that was that there was a new situation in the world which required the church to respond. We had just left the terrible destruction of World War II. You had the birth of the atomic age, the bomb, as well as energy. The horrors of the Holocaust was remembered by many. Science and technology, which we're so familiar with now, was coming of age and beginning to influence the world as well. So quite significantly, John the 23rd states that while ecumenical councils do exist to address difficult moments, especially when there are things like what we call heresies around, in this case, it would not be so. He says that it will be a distinctively pastoral focus of the council, rather than to correct or chart new courses of doctrine. And this is the statement he makes to the council fathers. The substance of the ancient doctrine of the deposit of faith is one thing. The way in which it is presented is another. And he goes on to call the council to have a pastoral dimension to it, to help people understand their faith and to live it. The first session of Vatican II began on October the 11th, 1962, and included 8 patriarchs, 85 cardinals, 533 archbishops, and over 2,000 bishops plus abbots. There were 68 superiors of religious orders. There were 30 observers from different Christian faiths, and there were 15 women auditors. There were approximately 200 bishops that were not able to attend because they came from communist countries and they were not given visas by their government to attend. The bleachers were added to St. Peter's Basilica, and so you had the nave, the aula filled with seating, and thus began the council. At the opening session, Cardinal Alfredo Ottaviani, the head of the prestigious Congregation of the Faith, presented the agenda, which had taken them 2 years to put together, and he asked the bishops for approval. Most of the curia, the other officials at the Vatican, along with Ottaviani, fully expected that they would get the vote of placiat, which meant it pleases us. It means yes. The Cardinal Archbishop of Cologne, Germany, objects, to the lack of consultation of the bishops concerning the agenda. A French cardinal objects to the contents of what was presented and objected to those who were chosen to be the chair of the various commissions that would discuss the various documents that would come forth. And much to the surprise of everyone, there was a thunderous applause from all the bishops, and the majority vote of non-plagiat for the agenda was heard and recorded. Octaviani was dumbfounded and not sure what to do, and then this is when John the 23rd stepped forward and stated that the proposed agenda was now withdrawn. So while nothing really happened in the first session, everything happened, because what came about then was the council would be open to the ideas that would come from the grassroots of the bishops themselves, and that would in many ways guide the discussion that followed. While no documents were done, something else happened. The patriarchs, the bishops, the women auditors, the theological experts who were called the periti, the Protestant observers got to know each other over a glass of Chianti, a cup of cappuccino, or a plate of pasta. Roman restaurants became a special place for faith sharing and for theological dialogue. I think this is sometimes forgotten, that this milieu existed. It is what I experienced as a seminarian when I arrived in September of 1964. There we had these gatherings going on, and what was happening is that people were beginning to know each other. Many bishops would state they didn't know anybody from South America if they lived in Europe and in other parts of the world, and so they got to know each other. In addition, I was living at the North American College. We had a large auditorium, a little bit bigger than this, and there we gathered to hear the theological experts who were advising the bishops and the various commissions. I can remember hearing Joseph Jungmann in liturgy. I heard Father R.A.F. McKenzie, who was the rector of the Biblicum, probably the Catholic expert in scripture of that day. Hans Kuhn, other people, Cardinal Koenig was there. Dr. Albert Outler, who was the dean of the Perkins School of Theology in SMU. He was one of the Protestant observers, and he spoke to us as well as many others. Bishops, other priests and seminarians from Rome, from English-speaking countries, would gather with us for those presentations. They were from England and Ireland and Scotland, from Australia, from Canada, from New Zealand. I can tell you that my world, coming from a little place called Hempstead, Texas, was expanded beyond anything that I could ever imagine. Pope John the 23rd discovered in 1963 that he had terminal cancer. And in June of that year, he says to his doctor, "Don't look so worried. My bags are packed, and I'm ready to go." And he closes his eyes, and he dies peacefully. The world mourns as it has never had mourned a Roman pontiff before. His easygoing smile, his openness to people of all walks of life, his simple demeanor captivated the affection and admiration of the world, among Catholics and non-Catholics alike. In the midst of the grief and the mourning, the church would turn to the Cardinal of Milan, Giovanni Montini, a longtime church diplomat, once the Vatican Secretary of State, a moderate who would serve as the next pope. He takes the name of Paul VI. Everyone waits to see if he will continue the council or not, and quickly he confirms that the council would go forward, and he did something very dramatic. He turned to the Protestant observers and he apologized to them for the sins of Catholics against their faith. So it was already marked, not only would he continue the council, but he would continue the openness that John the 23rd had announced. Thus, the second session of the council would prove the most crucial in setting the tone and the direction for the remainder of the Second Vatican Council. Several council fathers began to emerge as leaders within the council. Yves Congar from France and his contributions concerning view of the church as the people of God, or what we would call the communion of the people of God. You had Cardinal Sunens from Brussels and the emphasis upon the role of the Holy Spirit. Cardinal Augustin Bea in the area of ecumenism and many others. But the original leaders from the Curia were now kind of left behind. New leaders within the church emerged in the council. Study documents are presented then to the council fathers for debate. Little by little, a full text on the church's way of celebrating the sacraments and offering worship to God is prepared under the leadership of a Vincentian by the name of Hannibal Bonini. Unfortunately, Bonini would end up in Iraq because he fell out of favor with those who would follow up on the implementation of Vatican II. But he did something that needed to be done. He gathered all the scholars on liturgy and scripture and brought them together, and they produced kind of the skeleton of the document that we would later know as the Constitution on the Divine Liturgy. All that scholarship had been put together for over a century, waiting to kind of be unpacked, and that was his contribution. The Council Fathers were in fact delighted in the study text, and when they met, they continued to discuss it, and key concepts began to appear like vernacular to celebrate the sacraments in the language of the people. They spoke about full, active, and conscious participation, spoke about the importance of one's baptism, liturgy as the font and summit of the Christian life. In the reform of the sacred liturgy, the council states both text and rite should be drawn up so that they express more clearly the holy things which they signify. The Christian people should be enabled to understand them with ease and to take part in them fully, actively, and as befits a community. And we know some of the results of those changes. The priest now turns and faces the people when he celebrates the Eucharist. Another thing that's probably not recognized as much, but the place of Scripture in any celebration of the sacraments. When I was first ordained, you could baptize, you could hear confessions, you could do almost anything, and you could skip the Scripture readings if you were in a hurry almost. But the role of Scripture for any celebration of the sacraments. We had the development of a 3-year cycle of Sunday readings from Scripture, which many of the mainline Protestant churches would follow our example. We had a 2-year cycle for daily readings from Scripture. We had lay people coming forth being lectors or readers, and later extraordinary ministers of Holy Communion, and on and on. And the church was actually going back to its origins and to celebrate the sacraments as it did in the early centuries. And when the time came to vote on the Constitution, on the liturgy, the results found remarkable unity among the church fathers. Over 2,100 said placiat. Only four said non placiat. I'm not sure of this, but I think our bishop at the time from Galveston, Houston, was one of those who put non placiat because he was not happy about some of the changes. But I don't think you could find that kind of vote any place today. 2,147 for, four against. Anyway, that's kind of an introduction to the council, kind of how the Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy came about. And also there was another document that we don't talk about too much because it wasn't really of great quality, that on social communication, although its concept certainly was very important. I'm kind of the young kid on the block because I came in 64. I'm going to turn now to Sal DeGeorge, who arrived in 1959, and he will talk to you about kind of what happened at the very beginning and prior to the council. Sal?
Thank you very much. I think, like Chester was saying, we're kind of like fossils up here, and I never thought that would happen to me, to become a fossil. But nonetheless, what we're going to see in just a minute, if you saw me diddling here with my pen, I was getting my talk ready. Mm-hmm. So if we keep the lights off too long, this is going to be a very long session here. What you're going to see in a minute is the beginning, the very beginning night of the council. Now, that was the October the 11th, 1962. I was in my first year of theology then. And I finished theology right before ordination in 65. So I went through all 4 years of the council. I had been there 3 years prior to that studying philosophy. One of the reasons I'm here is because I was said, you know, why don't you come because you were there? Could you come and talk? Well, let me just give you a sense of what that was like. Don Nesti is with the Spiritans. He's a religious with the Spiritans. In their house, where he stayed for about 7 years, I guess, their house was right there by the Villa Borghese, I guess, right there by the Villa Borghese. How many of you have been to Rome here? Just raise your hand. How many of you have been to Rome? All right, there, let's look at each other. No, don't look at each other. This is, you're going to understand this because you know what an electric atmosphere that place is, and the church has a lot to do with it. So add that to being a seminarian. In those days, if you were a seminarian, you walked around with a cassock everywhere. We used to have to wear a little cape. In the oblates, I'm an oblate of Mary Immaculate. We had a cross that we stuck in our cincture and a cape, and we wore a little hat. So that's how you had to walk around the city. Now imagine a 22-year-old male American person walking around the street with those things on. At times you said, what am I doing? Am I in kind of a religious Disneyland here? What's going on? What's going on? And yet you started to absorb that whole culture that was over there, and especially in those days. So Don was there, studied with the North American with the Jesuits. He studied at the Gregorian with the Jesuits. Also Chester was at that big North American college there, right there, overlooking the Vatican practically. Studied with the Jesuit, the Gregorian. I was with the Dominicans over at the Angelicum. So there was always kind of energy working between all of these people. We were from a missionary congregation. There were only 17 Americans in our place out of 117 people. Our biggest achievement, I can remember, we had a little basketball team. And we used to always want to beat the North American College because those were the kids on the block to beat. And so we'd always go over to the North American College. They had everything over there, nice. So we went over there and we played this game. We beat them 1 year. So some of the people that graduated after there, they said, well, what was Rome like? Well, you know, we beat the North American 1 year. So that'll show you maybe a little bit of the camaraderie that went on between all of the people over there. and especially when the council hit then, we were studying. So we were saying, you know, council, what are those things? And we even had to learn all of the councils way back from Nicaea, Constantinople, Ephesus, and just right down the line from the very beginning. We said, councils, those are big deals. That's where people talk about the divinity of Christ, whether Jesus was really God. That's where they talk about the Trinity. That's where they talk about, and so these are big deals. So when we heard that this council was coming, first of all, we said, council coming in our time? Well, yes, it's coming. And so we'd hear little stories about the council. So it was really kind of an electric time. The backdrop of that, like Chester so well put it, was a very changing time in the world. If you look back in those days, well, you know, they were in the days around Kennedy and those kinds of things too. A lot of people look back and say, those people ruined the church and ruined our world because it would have been good if they just left everything alone. Well, the fact of the matter is, if you even look at history, things were going to be different no matter what happened. Those were the times. I'll always remember that when we studied, it was the time of people like Sartre and Camus, these existentialists. They had Christian existentialists too, but these guys would be up there talking about life and mores and people, and some of the things that they were doing were so profoundly Christian. Albert Camus, when somebody needed somebody to go take some experiments and ingest some drugs to see if they could get a cure, well, this guy said, well, I'll do that. Well, why are you going to do that? Well, that's for the human race. So we'd step back and say, that guy doesn't even believe in God. What's going on here? All of these profound activities without the knowledge of God. So those were the times. And then on the Catholic side or whatever, you had these giant minds writing these books about the beauty of the church and everything going on. So it was a very conflicted time in so many ways. And so the three of us found our place there of being witnesses to that and studying, some harder than others evidently, a doctor, a scholar, and I told Chester my claim to fame, he built a church, I built a barbecue pit in Huntsville. I said, so we were all in this mix together. You see, we're all in this mix together. And all these exciting things were going on. And as a religious, all of the bishops that came to the council, all of our bishops, we had about 7,000 members at the time, they're all over the world. They stayed in our house with us, stayed in our house. So you could see all this action and activity and excitement. So they were very, very exciting times. Now, here's how it started. You're going to get a little lesson in Italian tonight. You're not going to understand a lot of it, but you'll understand. Here are the basics of what you're going to see. It's going to take about 5 minutes. The basics are, this is the opening of the council, the night of the opening of the council. John the 23rd was going to come out and give a blessing. He wasn't even going to do that, but people just spontaneously wanted to march around. Some entrepreneur was selling candles. And so they all got a candle. So next thing you know, you have this big thing of candles walking here, there, and yonder, walking through St. Peter's Square, walking around. And it was like a magical moment. Chester was around. I was in the square. And so we were witnessing this. Well, you know, this profound council, what's going to happen? So on that night, the Pope was up in his little room up there, like a little cuckoo nest up there. You know, every time noon, the Pope comes out, the Pope goes in, the Pope goes in. He was up in that little room, and he was up there evidently looking through the curtain. And he was looking down there, and he said to somebody, there's a lot of people here. Well, you see, John the 23rd was a wise man. He was the son of a farmer. And I'll never forget the remark that one of our people from Sri Lanka said. He said, you know, in our caste system over there, it's kind of like India, our caste system, the highest caste is the farmer's caste. And he says, and that's why I have a great respect for John the 23rd. I said, well, why would that be? Because the farmer, you know, planted on the ground, he watches the crops, he makes food, so forth. And so he said, why would that be? He said, well, our saying is that you can knock the mud off a farmer and you'll have a king. And he said, that's why I like this Pope. That's why I like this Pope. Because he has an innate wisdom and a cunning. A lot of these things we think he fell into, he was thinking about that stuff. He was a very clever guy. You know, beyond the bonhomie, he was a very clever guy. So anyway, so here, this Pope, he was elected at 78. They thought he was going to die quick. To show you how things have changed, that was a big issue in those days. To show you how times change, the present Pope was elected at age 76 with one lung. Nobody said a word about his age. So that shows you how young we feel. We have a very young group here tonight. Very young group, you see. So that's how things change. Mindsets change radically. Anyway, so the Pope peering out, he says, you know, a lot of people down there. They're all, you know. So he decided on the cuff, off the cuff, he said, I'm going to say something. Well, the Pope never off the cuff said something before that. You don't do anything off the cuff. You have a little text, so whenever you would see the Pope speaking, good morning, hope, you know, no, nothing off the cuff. So all these people are roaming around down there. We're in the square, and all of a sudden we see the windows open. So everybody says, oh, let's look at this. So the window opens, and lo and behold, there's a microphone. And the Pope, you're going to hear his speech. It's in Italian, but it's easy Italian to follow. Here are the main things to watch for. He goes out and he starts off, cari figlioli, which means, dear little children. You know who used those words? Jesus, when he appeared to those disciples, he says, children, we heard it Sunday. Children, I'm going to give you a new commandment. Love one another as I have loved you. So he used that word. And then he starts off and he says, a lot of people are here. And he says, I am only one amongst you. I'm a brother. Now, the Pope never called himself a brother. I'm a brother who's become your father. And then he starts to speak, and then he says, this is such a great, beautiful night. And lo and behold, the moon, I think it was a full moon. I tried to look it up on the internet to see if it was, but I think it was a full moon. It was a full moon. Okay, so as he was speaking, he says, and look, even the moon has come to join us tonight. So when he said those words, you knew instinctively, whether you know anything about theology or anything else, that this wasn't a little event that was going to take place. This was going to be cosmic. It touched billions some odd people, granted, who were Catholic, and other people who were available. But you just had a sense that what is going on here is beyond anything around when he said that. And so right away, you just had a feeling. It was so touching that people, like, they dropped to their knees and they were crying. And then he continues and he says, now I'm going to sign off here. He says, when you leave, you go home and you give a little hug to your children and tell them that their father in Rome wants to, so to speak, bring compassion, bring love, bring protection, and so forth. And at that moment, you just felt, and I'm sure you just felt there was a magic in the air. Now, my sense of it is this. I'm not a scholar, but my sense of it is this. That was the whole Vatican Council right there. Prophetically, that was the whole Vatican Council. This is going to touch the world. This is going to be a tremendous moment of compassion. And so when you hear that, you'll hear it in a minute. So don't get thrown off by the Italian. Just think that you're at La Grotta ordering supper, okay, when you hear those words. But that's what he's saying. Dear, you know, you're here. Look at the moon has come up. You're from all over the place. Take a little message and a little hug to your children. That's it. And then, if you don't mind, we'll show that. I've always learned that little trick when I taught high school. If you weren't prepared, bring in a video. You see?
Cari figlioli, sento le vostre voci. La mia è una voce sola, ma riassume la voce del mondo intero. Qui tutto il mondo è rappresentato. Si direbbe che persino la luna si è affrettata stasera, osservatola in alto, a guardare a questo spettacolo. Gli è che noi chiudiamo una grande giornata di pace, di pace. La mia persona conta niente, è un fratello che parla a voi, diventato padre per la volontà di nostro Signore, ma tutti insieme, paternità e fraternità e grazie di Dio, tutto, tutto. Continuiamo dunque a volerci bene così, a volerci bene così, guardandoci così nell'incontro, cogliere quello che ci unisce, lasciar da parte quello se c'è qualche cosa che ci può tenere un po' in difficoltà. Niente, fratres sumus, stamattina è stato un spettacolo che neppure la Basilica di San Pietro, che ha 4 secoli di storia, non ha mai potuto contemplare. Tornando a casa troverete i bambini, date una carezza ai vostri bambini e dite questa è la carezza del Papa. Troverete qualche lacrima da asciugare, fate qualche, dite una parola buona. Il Papa è con noi, specialmente nelle ore della tristezza e dell'amarezza, e poi tutti insieme ci animiamo, cantando, sospirando, piangendo, ma sempre, sempre pieni di fiducia nel Cristo che ci aiuta e che ci ascolta, continuare a riprendere il nostro cammino.
That's the very beginning of the Vatican Council II. Now, if you notice, it's affected all of us here in a profound way. You bring it up now, this is 50 years later, 50 years later. And so when you think about 50 years later, there's a, if you're in a Hispanic parish, this is always the joke that's told about Vatican II. This priest was very on fire with all the Vatican II and the documents and the changes, and he got up and he gave a lecture to his the parishioners. And he kept going on, you know, Vatican II, Vatican II, Vatican II, and so forth. And at the end of it, someone came and said, Father, you're constantly here talking about Vatican II. We don't know Vatican II. So that's how the thing has gotten watered down. We say, well, what is this Vatican II? What are we doing here with this? But it's a profound thing that has really changed our lives. Now, my read on it, what's the point? We had a beautiful gospel last Sunday. When I was thinking of all of that, the Pope mentioned it there also. He said, forget about your differences. He says, you know, put that aside. Think of the things that unite us. Let's work on that. Well, if you notice, on Sunday we had a beautiful gospel from John, and that gospel simply said, here's the point. Here's the point of everything. the point of the Vatican Council, the point of everything, love as I have loved you. Love as I have loved you. So when the Pope said this is going to be a pastoral council, the compassion that surrounds that command, that's the last command of Jesus. You go out, what are you going to do? I want you to love as Jesus loved. Be faithful to each other. Love each other till the end. Sacrifice for each other. That's the whole point. So all of these documents and everything going on, you know, that's the point. And so when we hear all of this, it gets very complex. I've got this book of documents, and Chester said, would you look at this one document and maybe talk about it? And as I started reading, I said, oh my gosh, I'm back in theology. Why did they say so few things with so many words? And so I read it over, but it was a nice review for me, and I enjoyed the review. But when you get to the end of it, you have to start saying, well, what's the whole point of this? Well, the whole point is that this is the compassion of Christ being worked out in an international scale with a lot of theology. You have to have theology behind it. So when I thought of my evening here, I said, well, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to be here I want to be like Mary Magdalene at the tomb. My only job is to be a witness, you see, to be a witness. And what happened after that, I'm not sure, okay? So it was just an amazing event that touches our lives. Now, something we have to realize, whenever you start dealing with ideas and stuff, whenever you start dealing with ideas, things get very complicated. We just had an election. If you don't believe that's true, just think back on that. All the ideas and ideologies. So when we think about this tremendous moment, a lot of people found it very grievous. Seminarians, some of them now, not all of them, some of the ones that I've known, they came up and they said to me, you know, I had mentioned, well, you know, I was there when the Vatican II started. And his remark was, that's when you guys ruined the church. I said, are you in perpetual vows yet, or is there still a chance? No, but it's a point of view, and people really feel that way. You know, the church was so clean and neat before that. We said our prayers, we clasped our hands, we knew who's who, we knew what side, we knew what was up. And so it's curious how there's waves in the church. I thought about that the other day when the new Pope was elected, Pope Francis. Pope Francis has done a couple of things, among which I think he kissed some Muslim's foot. She might have even been a woman. I'm not sure how that goes. Well, I thought that was kind of universal. Well, someone came up to me and they expressed their displeasure. What do you mean? What's all this? Aren't there rubrics? Well, you know, you don't criticize a person. You have to realize the mindset. So realize that beyond all of this, there's some powerful mindsets that are being swayed. There's some powerful changes of vision that are going on. And so when you look at the Vatican Council, that was one of the blockbusters. When Chester talked about climbing Everest, well, that was it. That was it. And so it still has its influence today, you see. So the only way we're going to make peace with all of this is to say, well, what's the point here? Well, the point is the church is teaching us in so many forms, you love as Jesus had loved. And you just kind of put that there and say, ah, now we understand why things get so complex, because things are so simple. So anyway, that is my contribution. In that document, Chester, I become a better man after I read it.
Well, you've had two great presentations. One, the introduction and the background of the Second Vatican Council, and then you get this really warm, personal, profound witness on the part of Sal, who captured what the council was all about precisely in John the 23rd's sermon to the moon. I agree with you. That clip, those 5 minutes, captured everything that the council was about. Because the council was not only supposed to see itself as cosmic, but the council was supposed to give, and the word that the Pope uses is una carezza, la carezza per I vostri figlioli. He wants to give a caress to your children. That word caress, something in English, it doesn't carry the same weight as it does in Italian. When you give a caress to a child, I can't resist that after Mass on Sunday when people bring their babies out and you want to give a caress to that baby. He wants the church to give caresses to the world. He said at the end, which we didn't see, you're going to find some tears. The people are suffering. The children may be suffering. They're crying. It's okay. Give them a good word from the Pope. Give them a good word from the Pope. So I think that does capture, because John the 23rd said there are two goals for the council, unity and sanctity. It sounds very theoretical. But both of those, unity and sanctity, can only issue forth where there is the love. If there is no love, you have no unity. And love is the sole reason for sanctity in anybody. All the great saints, great heroic lovers, that's what they were all about. They knew how to love. So the council was supposed to come back and hit these two points and hit them really hard. A couple of light things for you to know. I was there at the council. I sneaked in to get several of the sessions. And in one of the sessions, as a seminarian, I was ordained a priest, but I was still studying. I carried my camera under my black raincoat, very respectfully, with my cassock on. And I went right up to the front of St. Peter's, right before the altar where they had the table of the presidents. And these presidents were cardinals, one of whom was Cardinal Ottaviani, who was the head of the Congregation for the Faith at the time. And Chester already talked about him. His coat of arms had a saying underneath, his motto, Semper Idem, always the same, never changing. And he's the guy that put all these schemas together and all of the agenda for the council, and that's the first thing that the council rejected. So they told him it was going to change. He was a very holy man, and he really wanted to make sure that the doctrine was there, because there are three things that are essential that the church must protect. You can never veer from them, because it's the essence of what the church is all about. It's dogmatic teaching, it's moral teaching, and it's liturgy. Those three things you must retain in their essence. Although you change the form, the expression, they have to stay there. So that's one thing. So I'm taking my pictures, right? Cardinal Cicognani was over there, was the Secretary of State, somebody else over here, and I hear this voice, get out of here. I said, whoa. I turned around, it was Cardinal Kroll from Philadelphia. Only a Philadelphian could be that rough. Mm-hmm. I said, well, I just want to take some out. Well, you know, St. Peter's is a big place, right? You walk a few steps, you go beyond a big pillar, nobody knows whether you went out or not. So that's what I did, I stayed there. One of the things I did between some of the sessions, I would go to these little towns where my relatives were from in Italy, and they had a wonderful parish priest in that town. His name was Don Tancredi Madonna. How about that for a name? Don Tancredi Madonna. He knew everybody in the town. Everybody loved this priest. He would walk with that little round hat, the black hat, his cassock. Normally the buttons were missing. One was, you had a buttonhole up here and a button left down there. But he would walk around in there, and he's walking down the street one day, and all these guys were standing at a coffee bar, and they said, hey, Don Tancredi. We heard that the Vatican Council could let priests take wives. We can even make that sacrifice. Now, what they didn't tell you is that I was in the midst of the tensions that existed in the council. Because as you know, change will always bring out fears on the part of people who want to live by fear. And people who are freed by love think, well, we don't have anything to fear. Well, there's a balance. And the opposition, one of the greatest opposition voices to opposition in the council was my own superior general, Marcel Lefebvre. Have you heard of him? Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre. I sat many times with him. I had dinner with him. He was a very genteel man. He was there and so forth and so on. And I could tell you story and story after story. But he believed semper idem, always the same. And he really thought, and he went back to France after many of the sessions at council, and he would visit convents and monasteries, and he would say, votes. Well, what are votes? They're pieces of paper, they change nothing. Nothing will change in the church. Undermining the everything that the council was doing and making people get more and more entrenched. And one day somebody recorded him, because if anybody would raise this question with him about, why are you opposing? Did I say that? Did I say that? Well, they recorded him one day. And they had the Cardinal of Paris call him in, and he went in, and the Cardinal of Paris says, you're going to this convent, you're saying that, you're going to that monastery saying this. And he says, did I say that? Boom. There it is. Well, ultimately, as you know, he became schismatic. He left the church, and he became excommunicated ipso facto, simply because he had ordained bishops in his thing. Well, these are the kinds of things of the tensions that John the 23rd was saying, we have to avoid this. Look at how you can love one another. Look at what brings you to unity and sanctity. So I was thinking about how do you communicate what really went on in this council? And I thought, well, look, think about a family coming together for a big reunion. And there are tensions in the family. They're having to relate to the outside world in their community. And you get the parents in there, and they're talking to one another, and so forth and so on. And it seems like the roles are changing. The parents were looked at this way one time. Now the roles change, and the kids are looking at the parents. And then they're all trying to say, well, how are we related to one another? You know, what's your authority? What's my authority? How do I get along with you? What kind of obedience do I owe? What can I look forward to my own, you know, responsibility? How do I participate in the family discussions? You know, I'm here, I want to participate fully. I mean, I want to have my voice and so forth. And besides that, what about the cousins? What about the extended family over there? And you know, these cousins that seem to have gone off on their own over here, how do we keep them related to all this? It's all about relationships. The Vatican Council was all about relationships. How the church relates within itself, and how this community, this communion, which we call church, relates to all these different aspects of the world. Looking for the basis of the relationship and not what separates. That's the key. It's a completely different mentality. Rather than focusing on what separates, you focus on what binds you together and what can constitute a little bit more unity and sanctity for that. So, I'm going to show you some slides here. Let me see if I can get that going over here. There were four constitutions. Now, what's a constitution? We have a constitution in the United States. It tells us who we are as a people. We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, for our security and so forth and so on. And we all pledge allegiance for that in this country. When you become a citizen, you have to pledge allegiance for that particular constitution. You want to be an American citizen, a part. You want to have voice, okay? They have four constitutions. They're going to tell us who we are and what we do. And as Chester said, the first one they published was the one on the liturgy, and the other one that they published was the decree on social communications. For me, that's providential. The schema, the agenda on the church came up, and they said, no, it won't fly. Sorry, this is wrong. We have to look at the church in a different way. Send it back to committee. So they said, well, what are we going to do? We can't wait. We can't just let this session go without doing something. Oh, take the liturgy. It's all ready. You know why that's significant? Because in the liturgy, which is the principal sign of what the church is all about, is all about, contained in that sign and symbol, about what the church is meant to be. He went over all these changes. You know, the priest is no longer looking at the wall. He's going to look at the people. It's relational, right? And they say, we want full, conscious, active participation of everybody. Now wait until you see where that leads. Because while it's there, and we thought that it meant previously, the Lord be with you and with your spirit, that we thought that was the participation they're talking about. No. What they're talking about is the participation in the very love life of God. Because we worship the Trinity, the Father through the Son, in the Holy Spirit, in the Eucharist. For me, when that was published and it came out in the New York Times, we got the text. Our liturgy professor took us right through that whole text. And you have to understand that I was in the seminary right between, as you were, we're making this major change from where the church was this, the priests were separate, you know, and the priests were supposed to be the holy ones. Well, poor lady, we can't expect the sanctity on the part of them. But everybody has a universal call to holiness. That's in the document on the church. It starts up on the mystery of God, and then it talks about the people of God. The principal metaphor of that document is the people of God. Everybody in the pilgrim church going to God. And then they start about bishops and their role. Then they talk about the laity and their role. It talks about the universal call to holiness, which blew our minds, because it used to be said that the imperfection, the perfect life, you're a diocesan priest, that was okay. I mean, that's fair enough. We can't expect too much from them in holiness. Then you get in an order like mine or Sal's, and we're at another level here. We're beginning to expect more holiness. Then when you get to the monks, I mean, you're really there. These are the holy ones. And then ultimately, the most holy were in a state of perfection, they called it, were the Carthusians. Now, you could always go from being a diocesan priest to a religious priest, a missionary, and then to a monk, I could move up, and maybe to a Carthusian. You could never go back down. You couldn't do that. That was a no-no. But here is the church now that we're talking about. Coming out of this divine revelation of God's incarnate word in Christ, we see the full revelation of God's love in Christ, and that is handed on in two ways, by tradition and by scripture. This was a big breakthrough. You know that the thing that used to separate us from Protestants was, we only believe in scripture, and you people have this tradition over here. We don't want anything to do with that tradition. Well, tradition and scripture are only reflecting one person, and that's Jesus Christ. And that's why, as Chester said, we share with other mainline Protestant traditions the same readings on Sunday for the whole year. They read the same gospel we read, and we have the same readings, with the exception of a couple. So we have this revelation which has made us church. And within the church now, all of these relationships are changed so that I cannot be a priest without the people. I am only a priest insofar as I am living out my role of service to you. We need each other for the complete communion. But it's not my job to lord it over you. And it's not my job to think that I have something, some clandestine knowledge that you shouldn't have, and I should be in another category. No. So we have those two constitutions. That's what makes us who we are. Then we have the one on the liturgy that Chester talked about, and then the last one I want to say something to you about tonight. It's called the Gaudium et Spes, and it's on the church, how the church is going to relate to the modern world. Now, would you believe that this is the hardest thing for Catholics to really get into? Social teaching of the church. We think of social teaching as a teaching, take it or leave it. Social teaching flows from love and the love of Christ, because the love of Christ has to have concentric circles going out more and more and more to the ends of the earth until we actually take into consideration the needs of all mankind. That's a big, big change in the way of looking at things. This is the church in the modern world. Let's see what else I want to say to you about that. It's split into two pieces. One focuses on the dignity of the human person. Never before in the church had any council given us a complete synthesis of what it believes about the human person. And by the way, you don't have to, I know it's a big book, I know it's all over there. You can take this and read this, you can understand this if you pick it up, because it's written in a pastoral way, and you can take it and read it for your own spiritual development. So if you do that, you're going to hear this beautiful description of the dignity of the human person, which is the foundation of how we live within the church and how we as Christians relate to the rest of the world, to the community of humankind, human activity in throughout the world, the role of the church in the modern world. And then it goes right into the fundamental aspect, the fundamental institution of all society, marriage and the family. And then it talks about how are we going to relate to various cultures through the world, these ways of life that people have developed for themselves. There are two ways. One, we have to look for the signs of the times. And you know what they mean by the signs of the times. How God's love is manifesting itself already in these places out in the culture. We have to relate to that. We have to call that forth. And at the same time, we have to bring the expanded vision of the gospel so that we can help people see the fullness of truth as it is revealed in Christ, and particularly in God, who is love. You know, Benedict says we have a year of faith. You know what a year of faith is, don't you? It means you take out the Windex. You take your Windex because faith is a window on the world. Through that window, you see something about God, the human person, and the world, and how the three are related. Windows get dirty. You have to take the spiritual Windex and clean the window so you get a better view, world view. And in doing that, then the best place to go for that is back to the Second Vatican Council. Somebody said to me, as they said this out one time, oh, that council, yeah. It made all the priests leave the church. I said, what? All the priests leave the church? Yeah, you know, everybody left. They got freedom. Oh, really? I'm not free. I'm very free. I'm very happy. I've been shaped by that council, and it has given me the vision on the world for what I'm doing in my ministry today. Then they go into the rest of this document. They talk about economic life, social life, political community, fostering peace, and how you bring reconciliation to the world. Two things, unity and sanctity, based on two other principles that are found in this: solidarity with all people, and the principle of subsidiarity, which means that people have to have the capacity to make decisions for themselves at their appropriate level in their community about what they have to do with their life. This document takes the principle of the liturgical document, full, conscious, active participation in the liturgy, in the life of God, in the love of God, and it says, you have to live full, conscious, active participation in the world. Now, my business is to teach this in relationship to the American way of life, which we call the dominant American culture. If we take this seriously, we are the ones who have the gift to bring to this culture which seems to be gridlocked. We have the key, which is the love of God, which will open hearts to transcend themselves from their cultural narcissism into an expansiveness which says, Christ intends for all to be one. Chester will tell you that the primary role of the pastor is to bring unity and holiness in the parish. The parish must model what is the Second Vatican Council. And you know what? You're already doing it. You just got to do it better. Thank you very much. Thank you.